We are back with part three of our surface mount soldering adventure. Today we're going to be frying up some PCBs on a hot plate. After we last soldered surface mount devices and I started playing around with the hot air station, I've been practicing, I've been getting better with the hot air station and doing surface mount stuff with the soldering iron, but I noticed that a lot of people are using hot plates and I thought, yeah, I want some of that. Now, I've got a little one, but it's not the same little one that everyone else has. Everyone else seems to have this really overpriced miniware one. All right, that's unfair. It's probably not overpriced. It's probably worth every penny. It's the same company that makes the TS100 soldering iron. But I didn't want to pay 80 quid for a little hot plate, so I picked up this one for like $10. It does pretty well. I've tested it with some of my little breadboard power supplies, and it worked quite well. But then I decided I wanted to go a little bit bigger. Yeah, I went with this one. The reason I went with this one is because the board I'm going to do today, I've actually done a couple before, and the small plate isn't quite big enough to handle it. So I got the biggest one, or bigger one. It's got a 10 by 10 centimeters top. So it's exactly the same size as the maximum size on the cheap PCBs from JLCPCB, who happens to be the sponsor of this video. Let me show you the PCBs that I've ordered, and we'll get to putting some together. This video is sponsored by JLCPCB, your one-stop shop for all your PCB manufacturing needs. Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, JLCPCB has you covered. Once you've designed your schematics, just upload your Gerber files through the website, choose the options you want for your board, and pay. JLCPCB also offers board assembly, so you don't even need a soldering iron. You can just order your boards pre-populated, ready to plug in as soon as they arrive. And now, JLCPCB also offers 3D printing as well as CNC milling and turning capabilities. So head over to JLCPCB now to see if they fit your manufacturing needs. So this is the PCB. I've actually made one of these up already. Well, I've made a couple of them up. I soldered up this one, and it's kind of a minimalist board. This was basically just to make sure that I could program the ESP32 and that it was working. Then I did another one. This one is a full working board, and if I actually give this some power, so you can see it's running a little test script that just tells us a time, and that's all the code I've written for this so far, because what it's actually going to be doing is quite complicated. You'll notice that I had these boards printed in purple. I figured I'm going to need some sort of prototype boards for testing and modifying, and I thought purple. P for purple, P for prototype. I'm also going to be making a few boards up for friends, and that's one of the boards that I'm going to be doing today, and those I had made on a red PCB. But these are ones that I'm making up to give to friends to help me beta test the code, basically. Because what this is a camera trigger. This is the intervalometer that I built on a breadboard a couple of years ago. So this is basically designed to trigger your camera using whatever parameters you set. But as I said, I started to do a red one and I put it onto the new hot plate and things didn't go as well as anticipated. I actually ended up melting the cover off the ESP32. So we're going to do another one of the red boards today from scratch. We're going to try out a few different techniques because I'm not using the hot plate for all of it. Some of the things like the IC are still probably going to be easier to drag solder. Here we have one of our red boards. I'm only going to put solder on a few of the parts. I'm going to use the hot plate for the really, really tiny components, and then I'm going to drag solder some of the larger components. You might have noticed that this is the same form factor as the Arduino Uno. I do have to clarify, these pins are not the same. The main reason I went with this shape of board is just because it was a handy footprint that was available. There are a million and one 3D printable cases for them out there already, and I just thought it'd be quite handy. But right, let's weigh out all our components and get them ready to go on the board, and then we'll add some solder on the board and get it on. So I need two of these little tactile buttons. We also have our LEDs here. We've got red, green, blue and yellow, and these components are all 0603, which I said I didn't want to solder. Let me look at my list. We've got one red LED on this, and we will pop you in this little tray here. So you actually know we won't. I've done this in the wrong order. What I should have done was put my solder paste down first. So let's do that. So here I have some solder paste and it's nothing fancy. It's just a standard leaded solder paste that I picked up on AliExpress. I've never used one of these in the plunger before. So let's see if we can push some of this on here. It's not sticking very well, or like at all really. Oh, there we go. It's starting to stick now. Putting it on with the syringe is quite interesting. It's awkward because it's difficult to see. Even with all these lights around, it's difficult to sort of make sure I'm hitting it on exactly the right pad sometimes. It'll spread out, it'll be fine, I'm not worried, and if I need to, I can whip some off. I actually think I prefer putting it on with my little plastic swords. Alrighty, not the cleanest soldering job, but it'll do. Now, for the LED, we need to check polarity, so I need to grab my multimeter. Now, I've got my meter in LED mode, like I had last time, so that I can check the polarity of this. Can you see that? You can't see that. Let me do it this way. So it's not lighting up there. I'll split that around. It's lighting up. So the one on the left is ground. So now I just got to figure out where the red LED goes and then pop that on the board in the right orientation. D2 is over there. So red is that one. So now we got to do green. And there's several of these. There's blue, ground on the left. Ground on the left, ground on the left. So that is all of our LEDs on the board. Two 22 microfarad capacitors. They're not polarized, so it doesn't matter which way around those go. Now it's just a case of going through and doing the resistors. Four 390 ohm resistors. There's definitely too much solder on some of these. I think we're probably gonna have a few bridges. I'm probably gonna need to soak some up, but it's fine. 5.1 case. These are, well, two of these are for the USB-C, so it can negotiate a 5-volt voltage. Two at the top up here. And then the other two are for the yellow LEDs. All right, now the rest are all 10K. There's about a dozen of these. So now anywhere that there isn't a resistor, gets one of these. When I did this the first time, I used this little hot plate and I had to solder the board in sections, moving from doing one bit to another bit and then another bit. And I didn't want to have to deal with that hassle. So I got the big hot plate, and the mistake I made with this was that I just left stuff on way too long. So this time around, I am not going to make the same mistake. That's why I'm only soldering on these little light bits with the hot air, with the hot plate, not the hot air station. I'm not using the hot air station at all for this. I'm using the hot plate. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to bring those up to temp and melt those components on using the larger hot plate. And then we'll come back and we'll solder all the rest by hand. I almost forgot to put my USB socket on, and I need to do it because I've already put solder on there. There we go, we've had a couple of bits stick up. We're going to just quickly fix those now. There we go, that's you and you. There's a bit of bridging in a couple of places, but we'll fix that with a soldering iron. So now we'll take this off. I'm going to pop it down in the slate to cool down. I'm going to use the liquid flux that I've got here. This is, who is this? It's got a label over it. I'll pop up a link to who this flux is, but I got it on Amazon and it seems to be quite good. Clean the tip off, get it looking good, and we'll go through and fix some of these. So there are a couple here. Let's go. See how they've soldered at a bit of an angle there. So what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to plug in the little one. We'll plug in the little pad so that we can just focus our heat on that one little bit of corner there. And we'll, so that the solder doesn't get knackered, we're gonna bob some flux all over these. See, one thing you'll notice, this is the other problem I had with this little hot plate. It's not quite flat. You'll notice I've got the board on, but I can still push it down a little bit more. So I'm just going to hold this down to make sure the heat transfers through a little bit better. Actually, I will grab a second pair of tweezers to do that with. So now it's saying 195, and that solder there looks, yep, liquid. We'll get you in level. I'm going to use the tweezers though, because trying to do that with the iron, it ended up sticking to the iron, and that wasn't fun. So now everything is sticking where it should be, and we'll move it out of the way and pop that band down on there. Now we've got the little components on, we're going to start with the bigger components. And the first thing we're going to put on is the AMS1117 3.3 volt voltage regulator. We are going to solder a blob on that pad right there. So there's the AMS1117 on, and you'll see there's flux everywhere because we're going to be putting flux all over this. I'm going to do a different tactic though with the next one. What I'm going to do, because the next one is this one right here, which is the TLP2914 quad optocoupler. So we're looking for pin one, which is marked in that corner. There's a dot on there. So what we're going to do on this, we put a little bit of solder onto that one pin right there, and we're going to use that just to hold the chip in place. And there we go. So I'm going to add a little bit more solder to my tip there. I'm going to tack down that other foot there on the opposite corner. Keeps it held on the board just nicely. All right, so now we are going to smush our flux onto there. We'll do some more on that side. This flux is actually really, really viscous. Now what we're going to do is we are going to pop some solder on the edge of the iron, give it a good clean, and I'm going to pop it down here and drag solder all the way along each of those. Now I'm not sure if the camera picked that up, so we're going to do the same thing on the other side, and you can see all of those are soldered on quite nicely. So I'm going to make this a little bit easier to see. There's a bunch of flux on down there, so I'm just going to do that, and all pins on both sides are properly soldered. So that was a lot easier than doing it on the hot plate. Now we're going to do the next chip, which is the DS3231 real-time clock. So we're going to put some solder on pin one, and then we're going to hold this in place while we solder it down. And then we're going to solder down the pin on the other side. And we'll do the same thing again. We'll whack some flux down on that side. And we'll load up the iron with some solder, and we'll run it across from one side to the other. Now the other side. And that's that. Now the only other things left to put on here are the ESP32, which we'll do next. We're gonna use the same technique of drag soldering with this, and it's an ESP32-S3, which means it has built-in Wi-Fi, built-in Bluetooth, and built-in USB. Now the problem is I cannot access the internal USB in that, so I am currently trying to figure out why, and I have actually got here some CH340s ready for the next iteration of the board. We're going to take our flux and just go all along that edge with it. And then we're gonna solder it on with these here. Every single one of them looks great. There's no bridges. Now we've actually just got to put our 2.5 millimeter TRS socket. This is what our camera will plug into. I'm going to put some solder down on just one of the pads and then hold it in place while I solder that one in. It's been a couple of days since I shot what you've just seen, and it's probably obvious by the length of my hair. I've gone through and added all of the through-hole components to the board off camera because, well, this is an SMD soldering video, not a through-hole video. So let's talk about SMD soldering with the hot plates. First up, the small hot plate. This has turned out to actually be a lot more useful than I expected it to be. It's really good if I need to rework just a small section of a board. I can put the heat on the one bit I want, remove the component, clean it up, and then solder on a new one. That's probably all I'll ever use it for. The big hot plate, on the other hand, I think I still need to do a little bit more research and experimentation with the big hot plate because things didn't go quite as well as I'd hoped they would. I think most of that is probably down to me though. There was too much solder on the pads trying to put it on with the syringe, and cleaning it off wasn't as straightforward as I thought it was gonna be. I did actually get a stencil for this board, but that didn't go quite as well as I thought it would either. The solder paste that I've got tended to stick to this rather than the board. So when I lifted this up, all the holes were plugged, or most of them were plugged. So I definitely need to look into some other solder paste to try to see if I can get some better results. I also want to try some other fluxes. Now, the fluxes I use for this work quite well, but they're a bit of a pain to clean off, more so than other fluxes I've tried in the past. So if you have any suggestions for solder paste or fluxes that you think I should try, drop them down in the comments. With all that out of the way though, what does this board even do? Well, like I said, it's a camera trigger. So let's hook it up to a camera and see what it does. So here is the board all completed, and I have a cable here that plugs into this Nikon D7000. I'm going to plug this into the camera here. I'm going to plug this into the board that we made. Then I'm going to supply some power to the board. So as you can see, we've got an interval set. I've started it off at 42. Some people will know why. This is just demonstration code. It's not a fully functional intervalometer yet. It's basically all hard-coded intervals. You can see it's counting down to when it takes the next shot. We can see the date and the time underneath it, and we can see that the trigger is active. But let's turn on the camera and see if that's really the case. All right, so when we turn it on, we can see the timer ticking down, and once it gets to nothing, it fires the camera, and you can see the two little LEDs lighting up here that indicate when it's half pressing the shutter and when it fully presses it. They both come on and disappear very, very quickly. So I made this board primarily for shooting time lapse, but that's not all it can do. Because it's based on an ESP32, we can make it trigger on whatever conditions we want. We can add a light sensor to this, we can add a sound sensor to this, we can add a GPS to this and make it take photos as you travel down the road. And as with the original breadboard intervalometer, we can hook other devices up that we want this to control, such as lights. Now, I haven't done any of that with this because the hardware isn't on the board for us to do that, but I will be looking into doing that in the future. And if I did want to do that right now, I can always make a shield. This one is a programming shield. This allows me to very easily hook up an FTDI adapter so that I can program this, because otherwise I've got to jam pins in here and touch wires to ports, and that is not fun. Eventually, once the code gets a little bit more developed, I will be designing a new board with a new form factor that better suits it. I only really went with the Arduino form factor for convenience, really. As I said earlier on in the video, there's a lot of 3D printed cases out there, and I couldn't be bothered doing my own, but I will be doing one in the future. As the code gets more developed, I will be open sourcing this board, and so you will all be able to download it and get the boards made up and make your own and trigger your cameras. For now though, our journey with SMD soldering on the hot plate is at an end. A huge thank you to JLCPCB for sponsoring this video. They supplied all of the boards in this project, and if you want to get some made up yourself, they offer 5 boards for only $2, and there's a link in the description if you want to check them out. But that's it for now. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.